Our opening words are from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God. God is in the midst of the city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when the morning dawns. The nations are in an uproar, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. So hello and welcome. Thank you for being here. All of you watching online too. I'm the Reverend Tricia Hart. I'm the developmental senior minister of this First Unitarian Universalist Society of Burlington, where Richard Kemp was an important, devoted, everybody knew who he was member for many years. We are here today, including those watching, as a particular community, a community that holds the important task and privilege of remembering Richard and of celebrating his life. Some of you knew him well, better than anything in your life, as father, grandfather, uncle, partner, as colleague, companion, and co-leader in work for justice, as a fellow congregation member, and as a friend. Some of you, like me, know him only through the stories of others. But it is good and right for all of us to be here, for each holds some part of his big story. In recalling Richard's life and his gifts to you, his gifts to this congregation, his gifts to the community and to the world, we all can learn how to put those gifts to good use in our own lives. Because it can be hard to do this important work of remembering and celebrating, it's good to do it together. You tell one another stories and memories of Richard that you carry with you. You've been doing that for days and months and years. And you'll continue to do that later on today and tomorrow and long into the future. Because you loved him, your work is to remember him. Today is a celebration of that remembering and of Richard. As is fitting in any celebration, there will be music today and stories. There will be tears, I expect, and laughter. It is through all of this, all part of memory and love and hope shared among us, the living, that the spirit of those that we have loved stays alive among us. And it is possible when we wake up one morning and find the whole world overturned and ourselves lost in the company of grief, a strange and rather wonderful thing can happen. The walls between us, between ourselves, and all the rest of the world can, for a time at least, melt away. And all that remains in that vast shared space is love. Mark.
Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod. Felt in the days when hope unborn had died. Yet with a steady beat, have not our weary feet come to a place for which our fathers sighed. We have come over a way with the tear has been watered. We've come treading our path through the blood of the slaughter. Oh, 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 oh. Out of the gloomy past, till now we stand at last, where we'll gleam like a bright star is cast. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who hast brought us thus far on the way, thou who hast by thy might let us into the light. Keep us forever, ever and ever on your path, we pray. Oh, oh, lest our feet stay from the places, our God, where we met thee. Lest our heart, drunk with the wine of the world, we forget thee. Oh, 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 oh. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever and ever stand true to our God, true to our native land. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound, loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught. taught us, sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun. Let us march on, let us march on, let us march on till victory is won. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever and ever and ever and ever stand true to our God, true to our nation, our native land. Oh, 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 facing the rising sun, true to our native sun. Let us march on, let us march on till victory is won. Oh, oh. His truth is marching on and on and on. Oh, his truth is marching on. Oh, his truth is marching on. Oh,
I want to thank you, Mark, and Christine, and Carl. Putting this service together today was a group effort in which I was definitely a junior partner and happy to be, because the person in charge was Richard. Richard had clearly had some expectations of this place and of all of us, and he told us some things that he wanted to have in the service, and the rest we were supposed to figure out. And I, having heard stories, I understand that that is a responsibility one needs to take seriously. So choosing the scripture that we might include in this service was for a man who took religion very seriously, had very high standards, to which I aspire as well. This was something that we needed to get right, so we tried to do that. There are two scripture readings that are familiar enough that you may actually find yourself wanting to say them along with me, which you're very welcome to, and just want to acknowledge that every translation of the Bible has different versions of the words. Don't worry about that. The first reading is from the first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of mortals and of angels, but do not have love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give away all my possessions and if I hand over my body so that I may boast but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. But as for prophecies, they will come to an end. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will come to an end. For we know only in part. We prophesy only in part. But when the complete comes, the partial will come to an end. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became an adult, I put an end to childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we will see face to face. Now I know only in part, then I will know fully, even as I have been fully known. And now faith, hope, and love abide these three, and the greatest of these is love. And the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Thus ends the readings.
I think we have volume.
Yeah, we need a little more volume.
Okay.
Woody?
Get him, Kathleen.
I used to know how to turn it up.
As we are in his presence today, let us turn to the one that we know as our God and offer up just a moment, a prayer. Prayer for the family, for friends. We know that Richard has left a huge hole in this community. We know that there were so many things that he accomplished. He had so much that was left undone, so much left for us to do. Let's pray for strength that we can continue the march for justice. Let's pray for peace for the family. All six siblings under one roof right now for the first time in quite some time, who've come from so many different walks of life, so many different challenges. Let's pray for peace for them, for their children. Let's pray for hope as we move forward together. Let's not let Richard's life, let's not let the legacy of his life leave us divided, but leave us united. Let's let Richard's presence here in his life be meaningful to the extent that when we leave here today, that we all leave unchanged. Let us pray. Eternal God, maker of all, creator of all, lover of all, God, we thank you for an opportunity to be in your presence despite the circumstances. We first thank you, Lord God, even for our own health and strength and our abilities to not just wake up this morning, but make it to this place. God, collectively, we thank you just for an opportunity to come together first today. God, for we know that it is good that we are together. And it is good that we are together in this place. And now as we honor Richard today, we do not come to you, Lord, to mourn our loss, but to thank you for his presence in our lives, to thank you for what you have given us in the gift of Richard Kemp. Each and every single one of us, our lives are different as a result of him. So, God, above all things, we come in celebration to you today. We come in celebration of a life of a man who was able to speak wisdom and to speak love and to speak mercy into the lives of all of those who are within the sound of my voice and beyond the walls of this church and throughout this community across this state and beyond. This man has truly changed the world, Lord, and for that we say thank you, and in that we celebrate today. So, Father, as you receive our prayer today, we do come with hurt hearts, because there is an absence that is left. We as mortal beings, Father God, can't help but to miss a person that we love. We can't help to miss a person that has left such an indelible print on our lives, Lord God. Father, we can't help but to have empty spaces in our hearts, Lord God, at this time. But God, we know you to be a God who is able to fill these empty spaces in these hearts today. And we call upon your power today to do just that. God, we call upon you to fill the empty spaces in the hearts of the people who have been left empty. God, we trust you to be a God who can fill. We know you to be a God who has done it before. God, we thank you, Lord, that you are able. And we invite you into our hearts today to fill the empty spaces that are left. Yet we still acknowledge the impact that Richard has left on our lives, and we choose to carry with us, as a part of that indelible print, a portion of what Richard has left in each and every one of our lives today. We choose to allow him to continue to live collectively and individually amongst the folks who are in this house and beyond, Lord God. And we thank you for that opportunity. So thus, Richard shall never die. And for that, we are thankful. Now, God, go with those who have come in this place today. Go with those who are hurting and sorrowful. And God, lift us up in joy as we leave now, God. Lift us up in celebration, Lord, as we come from this place, understanding that this is a celebration of Richard Kemp. So we thank you as you go with us, and we thank you as you do exactly what it is that we've asked you, because we know that you are able. We thank you, Father God, because we know that you can. And we thank you, Lord, because we know it is your will. Now we go. We go now in your name. Amen.
Okay, I've been in this pulpit before, but I'm really nervous right now. So everybody, take a breath with me. Remembering my dad means remembering his deep love for people, music, art, justice, good trouble, good food, family, activism, and very dry jokes told with a straight face. A little bit about my parents. They met in Friendship House, which was a Catholic Charities ministry dedicated to feeding, housing, and clothing people in need. From working with young men in the Rodman Job Corps Center, to shipping books to Africa, to mentoring people returning to the community from prison, he was always touching lives. Much of his life was dedicated to serving others. In the process, he always found the opportunity to have conversations with people about things we're not supposed to talk about at cocktail parties. When my parents got married in April of 1956, interracial marriage was still illegal in some states. He and my mom, Frances McGonigal Kemp, were willing to disregard racist thinking and defy unjust laws in the name of love. As was the case for many of his activities, he was ahead of his time, and he colored outside the lines. He liked using that word, colored. None of his 6 children, 14 grandchildren, and 6 great-grandchildren would be here if our parents had stayed in their lanes. Thanks, Dad and Mom, for your courage. At parties, over lunch, or during a casual stroll down Church Street, like it or not, you found yourself in the middle of a conversation with Dad about decriminalizing marijuana, LGBTQ+ rights, the out-of-control military spending, while many people are homeless, hungry, and without access to basic necessities, like affordable health care. When you talked about the politics of the Progressive Party and why he supported them, it didn't feel like a conversation about politics, but more so about a focus on humanity. My siblings will tell you that when we did something stupid, I don't know, I didn't do anything stupid. You do anything stupid? There was no avoiding accountability. It was never an acceptable excuse to avoid admitting your poor choice or for having caused harm. It was a very valuable lesson. Dad could never pass up an opportunity to speak with or without a microphone. He found it so easy to talk to anyone about anything, and he did talk to everybody about everything. He also taught us by example to question authority. There was very specifically a bumper sticker on a refrigerator that said question authority in very bold letters. Some of us children took that to heart and even had some fun with that, even with Dad. Dad was bold, he was tactful, he was courageous. He lived his life with a God-given freedom to be who he wanted to be. Most people who knew him say they're better for it. My dad could give a solid short lecture on any of the things he taught us, but he chose to teach us mostly by example. Like, I learned about the use of clipboards early in life, and it had nothing to do with an athletic coach's clipboard. He was always registering people to vote, showing us the lesson of it's important that you are registered, but also that you vote. However, there was usually more than one clipboard, or two, during election seasons. There were the petitions. I actually have the last petition that he signed right here with me. He lived a good life. I am very grateful. Although he was born in the times of legal segregation, He lived long enough to witness monumental historical change, like Barack Obama's election to the office of president in 2008 and the election of Kamala Harris as vice president in 2020. He leaves behind him a legacy of standing up for what is true, right, and just. I thank God and the infinite universe for my father, Richard Thomas Kemp, and for this opportunity to gather with you all today to honor and celebrate his life and legacy. Dad, you don't need a microphone anymore. We urge you. May we each follow in your footsteps by working hard to make the world a better place for all. We love you.
A letter from Bernard Sanders. Dear Kemp family, please accept my apology along with Jane's and our deepest condolences on Richard's passing. I knew Richard well, dating back to my years as mayor of Burlington, and am immensely grateful to him for his dedicated advocacy on behalf of Vermont and the Burlington community. Richard's decades of work in housing, racial, and economic justice are a testament to his deep commitment to the people of Vermont. Richard leaves behind an enormous legacy of progressive community activism. From his pioneering work to help the creation of the Flynn Avenue Housing Cooperative, to mentoring Vermonters coming out of prison, and support for socially motivated investment and community-based lending. Richard also broke down the barriers when he was elected as the first African-American city councilor of Burlington in 2001. Richard was incredibly generous with his time and talents, serving on the boards of the Peace and Justice Center, Vermont Community Loan Fund, Champlain Housing Trust, Community Justice Center, and CCTV. Richard was never afraid to speak his mind and always stood up for all of those left behind or left out. Richard will be remembered and deeply missed for the years to come by many of the people, it's the hardest part at the end, by the many people whose lives he touched and the impact on racial, social, and economic justice that he left in Vermont. I'm still waiting for my inheritance check. While nothing can make up for your loss, I hope that you are comforted by the thoughts and prayers of Richard's many friends, colleagues, and community members who share our sorrow, your sorrow. Bernard Sanders, United States Senator.
Thanks for coming, everybody. I'm Martha Kemp, Richard's second daughter, in case anybody here doesn't know. In the days following my dad's passing, there were some really kind and thoughtful sentiments that were posted online, and I just thought it would be nice to share them with you. This first one is from Melinda Gale. She says, I just met Richard about 4 years ago, and he was such a dear person. I was so pleased when they had a party for him to dedicate the Kemp House on Maple Street as housing for people released from prison. Richard supported many good causes, and that is one that he kept wanting to get done. It was so much fun to see all the many members of his family there, as well as many friends. It was frustrating not to be able to visit because of the pandemic, but the last time I was able to spend time with him, it was about an hour, and he was in fine fettle, and we had a wonderful visit. My sympathy to all his large family and to all the friends who, like me, will miss him so. The next one's from Candy. My heart is filled with such sadness. No words can describe how much Richard meant to so many people. He believed in me when not many others did. Every encounter with him, I was greeted with his wonderful smile and always ended with his words of wisdom. My deepest sympathies and condolences to all his family. Christine, I'm sending you hugs. Burlington has certainly lost an icon. And this is from Cindy. Please accept my sympathies in the passing of your beloved Richard. I was lucky enough to have him, to have met him and worked with him in support of progressive ideas. Sincerely, Cindy Weed. The next one's from Martha Abbott. Richard was a good friend to so many and a terrific human being. He was always reaching out to people in distress or those who were struggling. He's missed and will be remembered by so many Burlingtonians, Vermonters, as well as friends around the country and around the world. That's from Martha Abbott. My father was my hero. Thank you for the kind words, love, and support. And that was posted by Christine Longmore Hughes. The next one, Chris McCarthy. And this is to Christine. I'm so very sorry for the loss of your father. He was a great man, committed to his family and his community, thinking of you and your entire family. And this is from Tracy Brown. If it's a Tracy Brown, I'm thinking of longtime family friend from way back in New York. I was really excited to see this. Christine, I'm saddened to hear of Richard's death. I was driving home from a visit with my mom today when I heard mention of the Racial Justice Alliance, Richard Kemp Center. I wasn't at all surprised to learn your father had been honored in this way. I don't know much about his activism in Burlington, but I remember him having a good heart, which is at the core of every social justice activist. Much love to your family. And from Deb Bouton, Richard's passing marks the end of an era in Burlington. He was so much a part of what made this city great back in the day. May his good works live on in all who knew him. Do a special good deed in Richard's memory, sending love and condolences to his family and many, many friends. And this is from Margaret Bass. I send my deepest sympathy to the family and the loved ones of Mr. Kemp. The last one here is, I remember Richard from IBM days some years ago. He was always friendly, intelligent, and helpful. I know he was an artist and always seeking social justice for all people. May he rest in peace. He was a good man. Thank you.
Okay. A typical Kemp, right there. I'm pretty humbled to do this. You know, just it really touched me, and it's really not easy for me to do this. So, I feel in many ways not worthy at all. But so I asked Richard for advice, and he said, "Get over yourself. Get on with it." So thank you. And so here I am. And so I'd asked that CHT do its part in housing former incarcerated individuals and give them the housing they need. This would bellow out at every other board meeting that we had. His part of the agenda, he simply had that privilege at the end of all the regular business. And we all go, "Richard, we know, we know." And we do the best we can. And we have been making changes, I think, in his honor, often enough. He would also yell out that there's plenty of money in the world. When we said we didn't have enough money, he said, "There's plenty of money in the world." He was so right about that. So before I met Richard at CHA, I knew some of his kids, and I was a very young director of the King Street Youth Center, and I was able to work with neighborhood leaders like Maria Garrison and the Garrison family. And King Street Youth Center at the time was a place where actually black kids could go and feel relatively safe because of the Garrisons and because of what we believed to be the right thing to do. And so before I met Richard, I met many of his kids. I tell you, I know you were there. I remember you, the rest of you might have been there, but for sure, Kemp kids were there at the King Street Youth Center. Years later, I met Richard in political circles, both stalwart progressives. We both served on the city council, I earlier than him. I was the first Sicilian to ever serve. From Ward 5. Okay. Not easy when I first came here. It was not easy. Of course, Richard had a much higher distinction of being the first African-American to ever serve in Burlington's history. Richard was a proud member of the Flint Avenue Co-op, the first of its kind in Vermont, and a fierce advocate for affordable housing, and his service on CHT board was about that. He represented us in Angola, Africa, receiving the United Nations World Habitat Award, and frankly, I think that was a great moment for him and a proud moment for us. Frankly, everywhere I turned in my work, Richard was there. As CEDAW director, he was at the Community Justice Center. If I turned someplace else, Richard would be there doing some work that involved justice in some way. As importantly for me was our common history of being raised Catholic in New York City. There is in all of that a common desire for justice that rose out of that tradition. I taught by Jesuits, Richard and his path. Even as we left that tradition, there was always a quick, there was always that anchoring, I think, in terms of the work we did. But because we were from New York City, there was always a quick and swift and gentle sarcasm and kidding that filled our relationship all the time. We both needed that from each other. It wasn't easy always to do that, but we were safe in that moment together. Richard would always come on time for the dinners at CHT. They would start at 5:30, but dinner served at 5. Richard would be there first, I would sit next to him, and we spent the whole half hour back and forth, constant. Leaning over and talking to each other about the world around us. And forgive me for this, but he would often lean over and we would compare tan lines. Look to me on a regular basis, making fun of how white I was on a regular basis. But my favorite ritual was when I would see him strolling Church Street. In Italy, there's a tradition called La Passeggiata. No, I didn't get it right. Passeggiata. And it comes from the verb to walk, and it's an evening stroll that everybody comes out. The entire town comes out and visits and just walks and talks to each other and visits each other, usually at the end of the day, maybe right before dinner. But it's a conversation that happens. And you'd go into piazzas and see everyone there, everybody walking. It's a way for folks to connect to their roots and feel a sense of community and belonging. I think I did that a lot on Church Street, and Richard did that too. And so my favorite time with Richard was when I would see him strolling Church Street. Tall and proud, greet me with a great smile, and just the enormous mischief of the begin for at least a half hour before we'd wander off to do and greet and see somebody else. We'd poke and kid like kids from Brooklyn, thankful about where we lived and our lives. There was always compassion, there was always an open heart, there was always love, and there was that love for humanity. So we will miss you, dear Richard, we really do, every day. Thank you. I wasn't as funny as you wanted me to be, sorry.
Will you join me and one another in a moment of prayer and reflection, each according to your own custom and tradition? Maybe starting as Kathleen had us do with a breath together. Here we are in the company of grief and gratitude, smiling at one another in the light and through our tears. Richard is no longer with us, and that is simply hard to take in. Yet here, once again, courage will carry us through as long as we have love. Be with us, Spirit of life and love, God of every name and no name at all. Stay with us. Stay with us as we love one another through the good days and the hard ones. As we struggle to keep our hearts open to the joy of life, the blessings and the pain of love, and the work of loving the world into justice. May those who loved Richard so much through his life find peace, knowing that your efforts were good and enough. Help them to let him go so that he can live forever in their hearts. May all of us remember that life, sweet, difficult, precious, is a gift given us only for a time. It is not ours to hold forever, but to be lived in each moment with beauty and passion and grace. So may it be. Let the people say, Amen. And let the people sing.
So one of the things that is this on? Am I on? Yes?
Just get a little closer.
Of the things that I always loved when hymns were chosen in the sanctuary were the rounds, songs sung in a round. And so the name of this one that I picked, Sing and Rejoice, singing is a form of prayer. And we're celebrating. So Sam is going to teach us the hymn, divide us into groups. You don't have to sing. You could just listen to all the parts. But consider joining in.
Thank you, Kathleen. So we're going to sing hymn number 395. And if you'd like, it's in our gray hymnal, which may be in front of some of you folks. So it's very short. It's just 8 bars long. There's 3 short phrases. And I think what we should do if we're going to sing it as a round, we want to all learn it as well as we can, because once we start the round, there's going to be 4 parts. And each section is going to be in charge of their own part. And hopefully all will go smoothly, or be fun at least. So I'm just going to get my starting note here. And let me teach you guys the song. So the first, we'll do one phrase at a time. So the first phrase goes, sing and rejoice. And you guys? Great. And the next phrase, sing and rejoice.
Sing and rejoice.
Awesome. And the third part goes up a little higher, and it goes, let all things living now sing, let all things living now sing and rejoice. Let all things living now sing and rejoice. So let's run through the whole hymn just a few times as a group. This will go quick. So here we go. Sing and rejoice, sing and rejoice. Let all things living now sing and rejoice. Sing and rejoice, sing and rejoice. Let all things living now sing and rejoice. All right, how is everyone feeling? Is that good? Sufficient practice? Okay, so we have 6 rows here, and trying to figure out how to divide that into 4. And I think what I'm seeing that I want to do, the 2 rows on that end, you folks will be part number 1. So you'll come in first. That's either side of that first aisle. And then, let's see, okay, I think the second group is going to be these 2 aisles here around the center aisle, and then the third group is going to be you guys here, and including the family too, to round that out, and the fourth group is going to be the row along the wall here. And yeah, so sing as you're comfortable. And I'm only going to be, I'll sing the first phrase to start group 1 off, and then I'll sing that same phrase to start group 2 off, and I'll sing the same phrase to start group 3 and group 4. And at that point, I think I'm just going to let everyone go and see how that goes, because I can only sing one part, and it might be confusing to have me on just one. I might come in with group 1 at some point, if that's helpful. So, let's do one more run of it as a group, and then we'll start off. Okay. That would be great. if you can stand as you're able. So here we go, one full run through at the group. Sing and rejoice, sing and rejoice. Let all things living sing and rejoice. One more time. Sing and rejoice. Sing and rejoice. Let all things living sing and rejoice. Okay, so here we go. Again, group 1 is the first 2 rows, group 2 is these 2 middle rows, group 3 is the fifth row there, and group 4 is the final row. And I'll start you off in turn, and this is going to go by really quick. And let's sing it a good 5 or so times. I'll also, at the end, when it's feeling right, I'll signal off the end of each group and try to make that work as well. Okay, so here we go, group number one. Sing and rejoice. Group number two. Sing and rejoice. And three. Sing and rejoice. And four. Sing and rejoice.
Sounded wonderful, and I just realized that is the first round to be sung in this space since the beginning of the pandemic. Woo! You did it. I want you to know what I hope you already know, which is that the family is inviting everybody to a reception, which, I don't know, maybe it's not raining too much, and there is a canopy, and it's outside, so please, please do stay if you can. The family is going to, after the postlude, is going to leave first and meet us all there out in the memorial garden under the tent. The closing words, the benediction today, is written by the Reverend Kendall Gibbons. She says, "There is finally only one thing required of us. That is to take life whole, the sunlight and shadows together, to live the life that is given us with courage and humor and truth. We have such a little moment out of the vastness of time for all our wondering and loving. Therefore, let there be no half-heartedness. Rather, let the soul be ardent in its pain, in its yearning, in its praise. Then shall peace enfold our days and glory not fade from our lives." Go in peace.